My name is Jordi Cenzano. I'm an engineer at Meta, at the video infrastructure team. And today I'm going to talk about MOQ, also because I'm really passionate about live streaming, so this is a great subject for me. So let's start. This is the agenda for today. I'm going to talk a little bit about what is MOQ, although Mike English did a great presentation yesterday about it. And then I'm going to talk about why I think, or give you some reasons about why I think MOQ, we need MOQ. Finally, or next, I'm going to talk about how MOQ is supposed to work. And at the end, I'm going to show some demo. So let's start about what. MOQ stands for Media Over QUIC, and it's basically a protocol that is being standardized as we speak. So yesterday, I think the draft 01 was released in IETF. So it's IETF has a work group that is called MOQ. There is few of the persons of that working group are here. So it's plenty of smart people in a room just thinking about what could be a next media transfer protocol. And I'm just very lucky to be there learning every day. So this just started years ago when Meta, Twitch, and Cisco implemented some protocols that sends media over QUIC. So basically at some point, somebody said, okay, we should sit together and create some standard option to send media over QUIC. So where MOQ stands, or where MOQ lands on the network stack? So MOQ is standardized, so MOQ could run on top of RockQuick or on top of WebTransport. And what can I put on top of MOQ? Whatever you want. It's a protocol that is being designed for to transport media. So you can put CMAF, you can put other media containers, such as a low overhead media container. There is an RFC in IETF about it. Or you can put credit card numbers. So basically, you can put whatever you want. So why do we need another media protocol? I think that's an important question, and it's a very relevant question. And I think this is what we should try to avoid. So create another media protocol, and then have all of these advanced media protocols to choose. So let me try to answer that question with some very brief story. So let's imagine that it's your first day at work, and your manager asks you, hey, have a nice day. We are going to build some live streaming platform, and you have to design it. And the requirements are, we need to accommodate ultra-low latency use cases, such as video conference, and also UGC, and also high viewership premium live streams. And by the way, it needs to work on browsers and apps. So that seems like a nice first day at work. So let's think what we can do. So let's start from the basics. So we have one encoder generating one signal, and on the other side of the pipeline, we have a global audience trying to watch that live stream. So what we can do here? So this is focused, obviously, on transport protocols. So we can send this stream to some cloud instance, terminate the ingress protocol, do some processing, perhaps, then send it to a delivery network, because if my audience is globally distributed, so probably I want that, and finally send that stream to the audience. Okay, what options do I have today to do that? The RTC-based protocols, so WebRTC, WIP, so these protocols, they are going to give me a very low latency, so ideal for video conferencing. And also, I have another option that is the one that is used today for live streaming and high-quality live streaming, that it's in the ingest side, RTMPs, RTRIST, so whatever of those options are good. And on the egress side, usually is HTTP-based delivery, HLS or Dash. So those are two very different use cases and solutions. So why those protocols that are designed for video conference are able to get this very low latency? Because the information flows that way. So it's basically there is a relay that it does probably some processing, but it's very quick, so minimizes the buffers, sends the information to the players, and finally the players, the moment that they have the first video and first audio, they are able to start playing. So but on the other side, so the HTTP-based delivery, it scales very well because the delivery is based on HTTP, and everybody talks HTTP. And the ingress side is quite similar to the video conference. We are sending the data to that server. That server is storing the data, is chunking the data, eventually generates a manifest, eventually the players request a manifest, it unloads the manifest, it reads the manifest, and then it unloads the video and the audio chunk, and then starts playing back that live stream. If I want to continue playing back that live stream, another manifest is generated, the player requests this other manifest, the player fetches these other chunks, and it continues playing the live stream. So as you saw in these very simplistic block diagrams, the second use case is not very well designed for ultra-low latency. So let's summarize. Can I use video conferencing protocols for live streaming? Yes, I can. For low latency, it's going to work great. But then when I try to squeeze a quality, it's going to be quite difficult because those protocols are designed to favor low latency over quality. And also, when I'm trying to scale those protocols to millions of viewers, then I'm going to, I will have a very hard time because there are no commodity CDNs that can work with those protocols as far as I know. Can I use, on the other side, can I use live streaming protocols for video conferencing? Oh yes, of course. But in that case, I'm going to really struggle when I want to keep consistent sub-second latencies. So what's the solution? Perhaps MOQ. So here is what MOQ is trying. So basically create a protocol with enough knobs and levers to accommodate those use cases. So how that is supposed to work? So let me introduce a couple of concepts. So one concept now. So MOQ, as I said, it's planned to work on top of a QUIC. QUIC offers a tool or a feature that is called QUIC streams. It's reliable and guaranteed transport. So, okay, we are going to use that. So, but what happens if I send a video and audio streams in a single QUIC stream? So could happen something like that. I send one video frame, one audio frame, another video frame. Oh, bummer, there is packet loss, this gets lost. Don't worry, QUIC layer will take that, will take care of that for you. It will retry the packets. It will send the frame number two, and at the end, the frame number three. So what happened here? So the bytes of frame number three couldn't be delivered in the player side until the byte of frame number two has been delivered. So this is basically the definition of head-of-line blocking. And this is what exactly we want to avoid in MOQ. So how can I do that using only QUIC streams? So by the way, let me just put a side note here. In MOQ, there is an active discussion about using only QUIC streams or QUIC streams and QUIC datagrams. This is not yet settled, so it's totally open. But in this talk, I'm going to show only the example with QUIC streams. So, okay, let me introduce another very cool capability of QUIC. When you open a QUIC stream, you can pass an integer to that QUIC stream and say which is the priority of that QUIC stream. And then the transport layer, you don't have to do anything. The transport layer is going to take care of that. So if that QUIC stream has a higher send order, those packets are going to send first. Okay, so then let's see how can we avoid head-of-line blocking with those tools. So I have this video frame and this audio frame. Now the video frame has the send order zero, and the audio frame has a send order of 101. As you see in the example, they were both ready to be sent, but the audio frame arrived first. Okay, nice. And I use two QUIC streams. Now I'm going to, another video frame arrives, or the encoder produces another video frame. Perfect, I'm going to open another QUIC stream and I send it. Same example as before. I'm going to have, in this case, packet loss, drops, and now it's going to send it again. But oh, what happened? It just arrives another audio frame with higher send order, 102. So, and as you saw in the animation, the audio was delivered first. So basically what happened? The player saw the audio perfectly delivered on time and the video was delayed. And this in a video conference use case is exactly what I want to do. The audio was able to play, was playing perfectly, perfectly okay. And the video was delayed. So perhaps I had a video drop in the conference, but I had an audio with no glitches. And this is, again, a video conference use case. I want to preserve the audio because audio glitches are super annoying. And if the video, I have some glitches, so okay, be it. All of this has been done in the QUIC transport layer. So the application layer, the only thing that that it did is just put the right send orders or the send orders that I wanted. And then QUIC layer took care of the rest for me. So this is how we can achieve head-of-line blocking with reliable transport, and that is what MOQ is proposing with QUIC streams. Again, there is an open discussion about also using datagrams. And now, going a little bit deeper into MOQ. So we have media in one side, we have QUIC on the other side, and MOQ is proposing, it's creating three very simple abstractions to map media into QUIC transport. So the first one is super intuitive, super obvious, track. So the track is all my video information is going to be a video track, video track 01. The second one is group. The definition of a group is that I can only start playing an MOQ stream when a group starts. And this aligns extremely well with the video encoding definition or a video definition of a GOP, of a closed GOP. And as we see, as you see here. So in this case, I'm going to map GOPs into groups. And the last abstraction is object. Object is the most smallest thing that I can do in MOQ. In this case, I'm going to map objects into video frames. And finally, in this example, I'm going to map groups into quick streams. That means that every time that I have a new group, I'm going to open a new quick stream. Okay, for audio, I'm going to do something different. Again, MOQ only defines those abstractions. The application can map the abstractions in the way they want. In this case, I'm going to map one audio frame in one group, in one object, and the audio track is obviously the full audio. And then I'm going to open a new quick stream for every audio frame. So every 21 milliseconds, 23, depending on the sampling frequency, et cetera. Okay, now we have the mapping. And now another abstraction or another definition in MOQ. This is extremely simple. It's roles. There is only two roles, the publisher and the subscriber. So the publisher is the one who creates the media, subscriber is the one who receives the media or the content. A relay can be a subscriber and a publisher, and a relay can talk with encoders, with players, or with other relays, like in this diagram. And finally, there is a player, there is only a subscriber. And this is how the information flows. Okay, now let's go a little bit deeper, and let's talk about the MOQ handshake. So MOQ, as I said, works on top of RockWeek and WebTransport. In this case, I'm going to show a handshake on top of WebTransport. So, and from an encoder to a relay. So first thing, the encoder opens a web transport session to a relay. In the web transport session information, there is the URL path. So in this case, I'm informing the relay that I'm going to send information related to stream 1, 2, 3. Good. Now, publisher opens a bidirectional quick stream. Again, ordered, guaranteed ordered and delivered. And it's going to send a setup message saying, hey, I implement MOQ version whatever, and I'm a publisher. Are you okay with that? The relay says, okay, I'm okay with that. I implement your version, so good. And then the encoder is going to say, I'm announcing that I want to send you track number one. Are you okay? And then relay is, okay, you can start sending me track number one. Finally, the publisher opens one quick stream or more, depending on the mapping that I defined before, and I start sending the objects to the relay. Now the relay, it is receiving this data. So okay, here I want to do a very quick mention to a catalog track. This is we have a special track called catalog where we put all the metadata. This track is not needed if you want to do the most simplistic implementation. So basically subscribe to one video track and publish and subscribe to one video track and show video. But it's going to be needed in real world use cases where you also want to know the bitrate of that track, you want to know the language of that audio track, and so on and so on and so on. So can I see it? Of course, I'm extremely excited to show you. So what I implemented? So based on all of those super cool ideas from the IETF MOQ standard, I implemented an encoder in plain JavaScript from the scratch that is on top of webCodecs and on top of WebTransport. And this is the UI. You can see that I'm not a UI designer, or I'm quite the opposite of a UI designer. But anyway, it works. So basically, the first thing that the encoder needs to know is the relay who needs to send information to. Second, stream ID, so a random number to identify that stream. Then I have some max in flight requests. In this case, that request means quick stream. And finally, so expiration time. And finally, the video and audio encoding parameters. Also, the player is also producing some debugging data, interesting data for debugging. That basic timestamp information to keep the audio and video aligned or to check audio and video alignment. In-flight request, this is very interesting. This is the number of requests, the current number of requests or quick streams that I have in flight, and the maximum number that I've seen in the whole connection. And then if I have to drop any video frames or chunks, so when I drop them, and an exact reason why I drop them. And this is the UI of the player. So it's very similar, the input data, also the relay URL that I need to connect to, the stream ID that I want to play. And also, this is very important data for latency. So basically, this is the minimum audio player buffer. So this means that this player is going to start playing audio and also video when it has 100 milliseconds worth of audio data in the buffer. So this means that the number of samples that I have in the buffer are worth 100 milliseconds. And then another very important parameters for the for latency is the audio digiter buffer and video digiter buffer. Remember that the QuickStreams is guaranteed delivery, order and delivery inside the QuickStream, but I'm opening different QuickStreams. And that means that there is no guarantee that the QuickStream number one arrives after QuickStream number zero. So it could arrive before. So for that, I need to implement a digiter filter. So I need, in one side, to put all the information, and the other side, try to output the information in order. For that, I need some time to receive the information. And this is directly translated directly in latency. So basically, in this case, the audio digiter is going to be 200 milliseconds and video digiter 100 milliseconds. So this is going to add directly 200 milliseconds of delay of latency in my connection. But it's a trade-off. On the other hand, it's going to provide a better user experience because it will fix those discontinuities that I will have because data arrives out of order. What else? More debugging information. Latency, I also implemented a way to check to estimate the latency, so I don't have to take photos all the time of the two screens. And also timestamp information, this is basically very useful to keep, to analyze the audio and video synchronization. Very important data, receiver digiter information. This means the gaps detected, it means that all the gaps that the digiter filter was not able to correct. So basically, streams that arrived out of order, that are out of the digiter filter window, so discontinuities that I had to pass to the video decoder. This in audio will translate in audio glitches, in video will translate in video glitches. And again, more timestamp information to check audio and video alignment. Okay, so basically this is the implementation, it's a block diagram, a high-level block diagram of the implementation. In this case, of the encoder implementation. I'm getting the raw frames, the raw pixels from the from the video capture from using get user media, and I'm getting the audio samples from the audio samples from the microphone. I'm doing a very simple timestamp alignment here, and then I'm feeding that information to a video encoder running into WebWorker and running WebCodecs. An audio encoder, Opus in this case, also inside a WebWorker running WebCodec. And then I'm feeding this information into a low overhead container maxer. Again, there is an RFC in IETF that specifies how this maxer works. And then this maxer creates some packets, and I'm sending those packets to the MOQ WebWorker that runs on top of uses WebTransport to keep the MOQ session working. The player, exactly the same, but the reverse order. So MOQ web worker connects to the relay, keeps the MOQ session using web transport API, and it feeds the data, it sends the data to the low overhead container. Demuxer in this case, the Demuxer sends the data into the video and audio digiter buffers, and when this data is in order again, or even if there is a discontinuity, but it tries to best effort to put the data in order in a best effort approach. It's sent to video decoder and audio decoder that they run into two web workers. And finally, we have the raw data, the raw pixels that are sent to the render system. The render system itself deserves, I think, another talk, but a two-hour talk, because it's quite challenging to play audio in a browser, and on top of that, align that audio with some video using webcodecs. So, but I'm not going to enter into the details, but this is more or less how we implement it using audio workload processors, circular buffers, atomic, and things like that. Okay, relay. So the relay is based on top of a QUIC-GO. I'm using a WebTransport library, and then what I implemented is the MOQ handler. The implementation is fairly simple, at least at high level. So basically, if there is a publisher that say, hey, I want to publish a stream 1, 2, 3, track one, that the relay implements, implements an in-memory table that I store that session information. And then I have two, let's say, two subscribers that wants to subscribe to also stream 1, 2, 3, track one. That is also, that state is kept in memory in the sessions table. Then when the publisher sends objects, that MOQ handler checks the sessions table, and those objects are forwarded to the subscribers. There is a very important tip here. If you want to implement a relay and you want to keep ultra low latency, always, always, always implement read while write feature. So that means that MOQ object, the first bytes of the MOQ object are enough to define that object. The rest is payload. So this relay only reads the first byte to identify that object, so the track ID, the group, and so on. And then after those first bytes, it starts forwarding all the payload. If I have one subscriber to that subscriber, if I have 200, to duplicates or triplicates or whatever the information, and it's sent while it's being received. That way, I can keep the latency very low. And then I also implemented an object cache. This is not relevant for this talk, but since I started also playing with rewind and VOD over MOQ, if you want to do rewind and VOD, then you will need some cache. But for live edge use case, you don't need that cache at all. Okay, finally the demo. So basically, I asked my wife that she's in Barcelona to set up, to open two browser windows, one with the encoder and one with the player. I did the same here in San Francisco, and I set up a relay in Oregon. The round trip times from where I was here in San Francisco to Oregon is 30 milliseconds. The round trip time from my house in Barcelona to that relay is 300 milliseconds. And then we did a call, a video conference, using that MOQ implementation, and this is the result.
So now we are going to do a very quick conversational test via MOQ. So she's my wife, she's in Spain, and I'm in San Francisco, so hello, Pilar.
Hi.
Okay, let's try, Pilar, please answer those questions as soon as possible. 2 plus 2?
4.
5 plus 5?
10.
10 plus 10?
20.
Perfect. Thank you very much for your help, Pilar. Oh, see you soon.
Thank you. That sound in the background was my daughter. Okay, so by the way, yeah, a fun fact about this call. So while I was asking my wife to set up all of these two Chrome windows, I was telling her to do that with FaceTime. And the cell phones were connected to exactly the same networks. And I promise you, the experience in MOQ when both were set up was better than FaceTime. It's not relevant, it's one sample, obviously, but it felt really good. So, and this is some data that, some more scientific data that I was just getting with that implementation. So basically, same relay in Oregon, I was able to get a glass-to-glass latency, so sending San Francisco, Oregon, and then back to myself, of 193 milliseconds. Quality experience really good, so video conference or video conference plus. And same relay, but in Frankfurt. So same relay code, I mean, but in Frankfurt. So with a round trip time of 155 milliseconds, I was getting a glass to glass latency of less than half a second. So, and this is how I measured. So basically old fashioned latency measures. So taking pictures of a stopwatch and the screen. So basically, let me finish with just a hope. So that I hope MOQ in the future, it will help us to improve and simplify our quite fragmented online media ecosystem. And yes, so thanks Mike English for the excellent talk yesterday and introduction, and thanks all the MOQ members that some of them are here for those extremely cool ideas. So thanks a lot.